So here I am in a really busy pub in Birmingham, and I have the privilege of talking to none other than Michelin star Richard Turner. How do you do, fella? I'll ask to be me. So we're in here because your restaurant's all bombed out and we're having a beer in the sunshine.
Lunch, quick pint in the afternoon and then back at it.
Absolutely, yeah. So these interviews really, they're not to glamorise chefs, they're to get to the core of who you are, where you came from and why you do what you do, okay? So why are you a chef?
I'm a chef now because I don't know anything different. I started off cooking when I was 16. I started pot washing in a restaurant in a village where I lived, and I've kind of got bitten by the bug, and 25 years or 22 years later, I'm still doing it. Once it gets into your blood, it becomes a part of your life, and it becomes an extension of you, and you can't, you know.
We've talked to many chefs who at the age of 16 are washing pots. How did you get on at school?
I was quite academic at school.
Right.
Could have done an awful lot of things, but for some reason I got this part-time job in a restaurant doing the dishes on a Friday and Saturday night, and then one night one of the lads turned around to me and said, "Would you fancy having a go at doing a few starters up?" And I said, "Well, I'll have a go at that." And then the next thing I know, I was offered a full-time. I was actually offered a YTS scheme, which was five days at work, one day at college, which was your day off, so you get Sunday for your day off, and you get paid £25 a week for the privilege of it.
Fantastic.
And then the second year, it got to £35. But it's what I did, and it's, I always remember what my dad always said to me that when I was young, he said, "What you earn now is not necessarily a reflection of what you will earn later in life." Do you know what I mean?
I
could have got a job earning me £250 a week when I was 17. But the problem is, I'd still be earning £250 a week when I'm 42, and it doesn't quite have the same clout. Do you know what I mean? Whereas, potentially, I mean, everyone knows what the potential is in Caitlin at the moment with the likes of Gordon and everybody else and what they've achieved. You can earn as much as you want, I think. Within a band, you're never going to earn the same money as a footballer, but you can make a bloody good living out of doing something that's a passion for you.
What kind of food did you eat as a child?
Bog standard stuff. I mean, we always used to have dinner at the table.
That's important, isn't
it? And if we ever wanted to get down from the table when we were kids, we always had to thank our parents for our meal. And, do you know what I mean? It was, we were taught,
like,
when we were about 11, we used to go to France every year. And my dad and I were always quite adventurous in what we ate. So we'd have bowls of, it's not adventurous now, but we'd have bowls of mussels and freedom airs and stuff like that. You get a bowl of mussels and there'll be little crabs running around. Like, my mum and my sister off screaming, and me and my dad eating them. But I suppose that kind of developed our food. I mean, you know, we've always eaten well. It's never been crap. My mum's always cooked, my dad's always cooked, and we've never had processed meals and stuff like that.
I think what's key,
I probably eat more processed food now than when I was
talking. Well, the decorator's house is always last to be painted, isn't it? Something that really comes across from top chefs is that very few, if any, are born with a silver spoon in their mouth. All these like top chefs come from ordinary backgrounds.
I came from a good background. My dad both worked, lived in a nice house. I could have gone to university if I wanted to go to university.
Yeah.
My sister went to the Royal School of Ballet down in London. So, I mean, there was an opportunity there, but it's just something grabbed hold of me. And
okay, so between 18...
And it was something I was good at as well, I think, which made a difference.
Sorry?
It was something I've always been good at, without wishing to sound...
Well, I'm going to get onto that in a few minutes about like innate skill and muscle memories and all that kind of stuff. When you went to college, you went to college, did you?
I went to college one day a week, yeah.
All right, yeah, of course, the YTS. And when you went into full-time employment, as it were, how difficult was it for you to learn? How difficult was it for you to... Was it clunky at first? Were you trying to catch knives when they fell off tables and like burning your hands and all that kind of stuff?
No.
Okay, so you took to it quickly.
I always seemed to pick it up quite quickly. Because I made it my mission to make sure that I picked it up quickly.
Right, so like you're talking about the intellectual...
I mean, it's an intellectual, just something inside me drove me to do it. I just wanted, if someone showed me how to do something, I wanted to do it as well as them, if not better than them, and do it as quickly as possible.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I didn't want to be the last one in the class that could learn how to turn a carrot.
Yeah, yeah.
Chiffonardus or cabbage or cut brumoise or, you know, I always wanted to be the first one to do it.
How old were you when you felt you could begin to boss food and you knew, so 16 smells in the kitchen and you know that that's the smell of lamb, just pink. Well, how old were you when the instinct began to kick in at that level?
I don't really know. I don't know whether it has completely kicked in. I don't know whether it has.
But you don't make mistakes now, do you?
Of course we do.
No, no, but you don't make fundamental mistakes.
I don't make fundamental mistakes, but then as you get better, the smaller a mistake, the bigger the mistake falls to you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, what was an incidental mistake when you were a kid? You know, to me, now would be a catastrophe.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So it's all about fine margins now.
Yeah, I mean, it is. Or you don't get me wrong, there are times we all get it wrong, don't we? It's like Marco said. Every time Nick Fowler went out to play golf, didn't get a hole in one, did he?
Yeah.
But the problem with it is now, is that people's expectations levels when they come to restaurants.
Yeah.
They won't tolerate it. But you are, you know, by the law of nature, you know, people, things do go wrong. I think it's as you get older and as you, so when you're on business, it's how you handle it.
So, like, what's a big mistake for you? Maybe seasoning off, or?
Yeah, salt's one of them.
Right.
And more and more now, I think, more and more as we develop new techniques, and I'm still a little bit amiss as to whether it's the right route for me as a cook to go down to. I have an opinion on whether I think it's the right route for cooking to go down, and in general I think it's the old adage, you know, you get kids now, come out of college, put something in a water bath, 15 minutes, 62 degrees, it's cooked. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That can't be done until you learn the fundamentals.
No, and the problem with it is, I mean, we were embracing new cooking techniques. I mean, we're using water baths when we're cooking fish. I've got a fish dish at the moment, which is like a filling map, and we're quick, so we pinbone it and then season it with coriander, salt, and sugar, and all that. And cook it for 8 minutes at 48 degrees. Blanch it first. 30 seconds so you can eat the skin, but then we've had a few come back with people saying, hey, cooked,
right?
But it is cooked.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But to their conception, it's not cooked, and then all of a sudden it becomes a little bit of a battle because you're thinking, I'm better off just taking a piece of mackerel, put it in a red hot pan, skin as crisp as possible.
Yeah,
then you don't have that problem, let's be honest.
Yeah, of course, yeah, yeah.
Great way to eat mackerel.
Yeah, but that's the difference between being...
But then the other way is a nice way to eat mackerel as well, and it's just people have to open their... I mean, I've had an absolute nightmare for the last 2 weeks with chicken.
Right, yeah.
I put chicken on my lunch menu, and it's coming back, it's raw.
They don't understand it, do they?
It's not fucking raw. It was fucking raw, I wouldn't have sent it out.
Yeah.
It's not raw, it's pink in the middle.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's 2012, not 1912.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Everything's reared so that you can... It's not, but your old granny who's 65 and coming out for dinner and you stick a piece of pink chicken down in front of her. I think you whipped your cock out and put it on the table. What's that? It's like, whoa, what's that?
I tell you what, like, I know you know Johnny Barron now. I know it. Yeah, Johnny, if you're listening. So just kind of give us an overview of your career. Where did you get your best training from? Where did you feel you were made?
Well, I started working at this restaurant in Liverpool called Frail, which is where I started washing. And the guy that I work for, bless him, God rest his soul, he's dead now. A guy called James Thomas. And he was nothing like, I suppose the closest you could get to describing him would be like somebody like Keith Floyd. You know, on a Thursday morning we'd have 4 crates of langoustines come down from Scotland, 2 bags of Queenies, 100 oysters, and then a Friday morning we'd have sides of lamb coming in. But the cooking was nothing. He used to do like Cote de Boeuf in big black La Creuset dishes.
Yeah.
And then every Thursday night he'd make a sit down, I think 16, 17, he'd make a sit down and he'd open a dozen oysters and a bottle of Chablis or something and we'd sit there and talk to him about food. And I think that probably developed my understanding of food, developed my appreciation of food. I mean, I'm a 17-year-old kid, sit down and eat oysters.
Yeah.
17-year-old kids now are out thinking,
I would like to ask how old you are, mate.
18.
80s.
It's only been a year. I'm 42 this year.
42, okay, we're all the same generation here. Who has been, in terms of your cooking style now, who would be, who do you look to as being the biggest inspiration?
Philip Howard.
Philip Howard. Yeah, yeah. And why is that?
He just epitomises everything that I believe in.
And what is that?
He cooks with the seasons. I watched a thing that he did on YouTube a couple of weeks ago with some foie gras. He didn't use water baths. I think he's got one water bath that he uses to cook his foie gras in. But it's just good, honest French cooking using the best season of produce. Simple, isn't it, really?
Okay.
No asparagus in January. No raspberries in November.
Oh, well, no.
Sea trout when it's in. You know what I mean? Oysters when they're in. Langoustine. Do you know that kind of thing?
And do you think the public understand the seasons?
Well, I mean, I have had instances where we went quite gamey last year, and I had some woman write a review on TripAdvisor saying hated it, because there was hare on, there was partridge on, there was. It's not everyone's cup of tea, is it? But at the end of the day, it's you should cook with the seasons.
Okay, if I work for you, how would I find you as a boss?
I'd like to think that you find me as a boss fair.
Fair.
And the ball is very much in your court.
Yeah.
If you want to come and act like a clown, you'll get exactly what you deserve.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
If you want to come and get your head down, be serious, be professional, get on with it, you'll find somebody that will take you as far as you want to go.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I can't suffer falls, I hate it. I don't want to be in the kitchen 18 hours a day with a bunch of fucking kids just crying about this. At the end of the day, I want to be around professional people.
How do you find the colleges? Are they providing good education these days?
No.
Why?
Because they're more interested in money than they are in anything else.
Okay.
From what I've been told, and that's only what people have told me, I've spoken to certain individuals at certain colleges and said that if they don't get so many people through a course each year, they won't get as much funding for next year.
How much of a gap is there between education and
industry? There's always going to be a gap, isn't there? There's always going to be a massive gap between, because it's completely different. Going back to when I was at college, I probably shouldn't say this, because I've been working in a restaurant and my lecturer told me it was going to take us 45 minutes to make hollandaise.
Yeah.
So I made 15 minutes, put him down in front of it, and said, don't take 45 minutes to make hollandaise. No. It takes 45 minutes to make it out of college. When you're in a professional kitchen, if it takes you 45 minutes to make hollandaise, you ain't going to wait, you're going to work.
What do you want to see from your chefs?
Professionalism. The desire to just do the job as well as it can be done. You know, because there's a lot of kids out there that are really good cooks. I think they just need to get a level of professionalism. Okay. You look at Wayne Rooney's, how old's Wayne Rooney? 25. Okay, he might be an idiot, but when he's out on the football field, he ain't the clown. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
It's impossible for kids of that age to be professional.
Yeah.
It's a time and a place to have a laugh and look at that. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Do you think there's a different breed of a different generation coming through?
Yeah, definitely.
And is it?
No, it's not a good thing.
No, it's not a good thing.
Next question.
No, okay. You're a mind reader.
No. I don't know. Maybe I've just been unfortunate, and I haven't seen the best of it. Don't get me wrong. I've got one kid who's just come to work for me. Who's 20. Gets his head down. But for every one that I get like that, you get 10 that just want to act the clown. Do you know what I mean? And kitchens are hard places, but I mean, I'm certainly having to adjust to the fact, you know, you have to accept that people have a life act, like accept people have a life act,
Yeah, I knew that. I'll take it, mate. Yeah, take it.
Hello.
Fantastic.
Simon, I'm just actually in the middle of an interview. Can I call you back?
That's great. That's actually in line with tradition. Everyone rings during interviews, and I don't edit them out. Where do you see yourself in 5 years?
Still doing what I'm doing.
Why is it that a lot of less talented guys are plastered all over the TV, and we don't see much of you?
It's
a very good answer. Very, very pertinent answer, and I hope some guys are watching this.
And people do, not all of them. But I did a little bit down that one way. two or three months down there in 2000. And Gary Jones is in there every day.
Right.
You know, 9 o'clock in the morning, he's there all afternoon, he does a little bit, and you've got to.
Yeah.
I'm a firm believer, if you're going to, and maybe I'm the one that's wrong and everybody else is right.
Yeah, go on.
If I'm going to, you know, someone's coming into my restaurant and I'm charging them £100 for dinner with wine.
Yeah.
They want to see a stamp of me on it, don't they?
Yeah. Okay, that kind of leads me on to my next
one. My food, so I should be there. See, I'll do the mise en place, check the mise en place, taste the sauces, do this, do that, make this. This is my job.
Yeah.
What am I here to do? You come into my restaurant for me to cook for you. You're not coming to my restaurant for somebody else to cook for you.
Yeah. How do you learn and develop yourself personally?
In the moment, just try and ram as much knowledge in as you can.
Right.
I mean, we are now in an age where it's, I mean, I can do a dish up there, photograph it, send it to my lad on the larder, and he's got a dish on his mobile phone. Couldn't do that 10 years ago.
No.
Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah.
But then I always remember, because I've always had a bit of a, always had a bit of a head fuck for stuff like this. Is probably the wrong word, but I mean, I always remember going, obviously, like I said, I did a little bit of my wife. You look at the way that they run that kitchen, you've got 48 guys in the kitchen. Have you ever seen a recipe?
Yeah, absolutely.
Check with sous chef.
Yeah, blah, the blah, control.
Blah. Reduce 250ml of brandy to 150.
Yeah.
But check sous chef. Do you know what I mean? And it's all farmers like, and it's got to be like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I remember I only went to eat at one of Marco's places. And I was talking to the kid who worked at the pastry chef. The pastry chef. And I said to him, I said, yeah, look at your recipe files. And he said, yeah. I'm expecting him to bring out a book. Like that. What the fuck's that? It's very simple. He said, you work for Marco. He shows you. You don't know how to do it. Marco.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So there's that.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
There's that. And I am very much, unfortunately, of that. That's what goes on the dish, that's how you do it.
Yeah.
Pick it up, and that's, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like I say, we are in a wonderful world. You've got the internet, you've got mobile phones, and you can watch what people are doing. And there's an awful lot of really exciting stuff out there at the moment. I think you've just got to
try to get time to dine out and to network.
Yeah, I went to Blubbercast on Sunday.
All right, see you well.
I went to Pennell's yesterday for lunch.
Then, all right.
But it's important, and it's important to go, not to nick ideas off people, but just to see what people are doing. And
yeah.
You know, and you can learn, and you can, at the end of the day, if it gives you a kick up the arse as well, because you think, if they're doing that better than I'm doing it.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Let's get better.
So you're 42?
Yeah.
Are you married?
Yeah.
You got kids?
No.
But even being married, is that, like, does the job put, like, marriage under stress?
Of course it does, yeah. I'm quite fortunate because my wife works next door.
Right, okay.
But I mean, it puts a very, she loves food now as well, so that's an added advantage. I mean, of course it puts a stress. It puts a stress on your personal life. You know, I'd be a liar if I said it didn't.
But like, the stress is out of balance by the fact that you do enjoy your job.
I love what I do.
Yeah, and it shows.
And going out to places makes me love it even more, because there are times when you stand in your own kitchen all day and you're thinking, why am I doing this? What am I doing this for? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's hard work.
Yeah, it is hard work.
It is hard work.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay.
But it's rewarding, and it's, you know, it's... And now as well, it's getting better now, because the summer nights are coming and you've got all the new projects coming through and you've got lamb and stuff like that.
So what kind of supplies are you using?
Well, probably the same as most people that work at this level of restaurant is. I use all Brianna for my meat. I'll probably just start using a new butcher. Chef Direct.
Yeah.
Wellocks, Ritter's, all kinds of, you know, people will use similar suppliers, aren't
they? Absolutely, just to get that real.
Because we are very, I am very much based around the produce. So you've got to work with the best suppliers to get the best produce.
Absolutely.
You can't punish a turd, don't matter how much you try, does it really?
Yeah, yeah. Final question. If you, well, perhaps not. I've just got another couple just popped in. If you weren't a chef, what would you be?
Rock and roll star.
Rock and roll star. Well, I'll tell you what, the way chefs are covered these days, I think you've
closest,
done.
I always said, it's the closest, it's the only way I'll, it's the closest I'll ever get to being a rock star.
Yeah, yeah.
By being a chef.
What football team do you support?
I'd rather not.
No, you're not good. Come on.
The Villa.
That's all right.
No, it's not.
Are you going to keep in the Premiership this year?
No, probably not. I hope they don't.
Eh?
I hope they get relegated.
Oh, my God.
Because then they'll get exactly what they deserve.
Yeah, yeah. That's not good, is it?
Not good.
That's okay. Okay. Okay, final question. If your food is an extension of your personality, who are you?
God, I've never asked that. What am I as in what? As am I in a dish?
Yeah. Are you elegant? Are you refined? Are you
Marmite.
Robust?
Hey, Marmite.
Well, Richard,
I'm a Marmite, that'll do.
Mate, you're not just a chef, you're a visionary chef. And it's been a cracking interview, mate. Really nice to meet you.